knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Like all other sciences, forensic science is based on certain principles and laws. They serve as the foundation for CSI. Altogether, there are 6 important principles of FS, which we will learn about in detail before moving on to actual investigative techniques. The first principle is the law of individuality. It states that every object, natural or man-made, has an individuality, uniqueness, which is not duplicated in any other object. Or in other words, no two things in this universe are alike, even when they are manufactured in the same machine one after the other. At face value, it appears to contradict the observations we make in our daily lives. In nature, particles of soil, grains of sand and salt, leaves and seeds of the same plant, hair, fiber, and monozygotic twins look exactly alike. Man-made objects like currency notes, footwear of the same brand, documents from the same model of typewriter or photocopier, these things seem indistinguishable. However, certain unique characteristics are always present. Some of them might be incorporated in the material during the manufacturing process itself, due to flaws in the material, varying electric current, defects of the machine, inclusion of some contaminant, etc. Some individual characteristics might be acquired later. 2 footwear impressions of the same model of the same brand may look similar on the surface, but there might be certain wear and tear marks present in them, which are acquired during the course of their usage. These marks will make them unique. If they are present at the same location, then it can be concluded that the impressions belong to the same footwear by the law of individuality. This principle is used for analyzing every type of evidence, but its most extensive application is in studying fingerprints. No two people have the same fingerprints. 2 fingerprints from the same person have never been found to be identical as well. In a series of experiments, fingerprints were collected from the same person using the same ink and paper a number of times. However, no 2 impressions from the same fingers could be perfectly superimposed. This is because each impression will differ from the other in terms of imperfect inking, pressure applied by the finger, slight varying of the texture of the paper, interferences from contaminants, and so forth. Thus, the law of individuality is held here. Anything and everything present on the crime scene has its individuality. Therefore, this principle is of fundamental importance in CSI, as it assists in establishing the presence of the victim, the suspect, or the witnesses on the crime scene. The second principle is the law of progressive change. It states that everything changes with the passage of time. Thus, according to this law, all pieces of evidence found on the crime scene change over time. The rate of change is different for each type of evidence. If biological fluids present on the crime scene are not detected and collected immediately, they will decay or be destroyed through the action of different factors such as weather, the presence of other humans or animals, etc. If the crime scene is not secured as soon as possible, evidence might get displaced, which will hinder the course of investigation. The longer the delay in examining the crime scene, the greater the changes will be. Take, for example, a hit-and-run case where a truck has hit a bike and sped away. Broken glass, bloodstains, paint chips, tire and skid marks, these will be important evidence for investigating such a scene. If the scene is not secured as early as possible, evidence will be absolutely unrecognizable due to the combined action of the weather and other vehicles speeding on the road. Not only evidence present on the crime scene, but human beings involved in the crime also undergo changes other than the permanent features, such as fingerprints. The more time it takes to discover a corpse, the more difficult it will get to answer questions such as the identity of the person, cause of death, time since death, and so forth. In cases such as sexual assault, incriminating evidence present on the victim and the accused, such as semen and bloodstains, pubic hair, and injury marks, might get destroyed or displaced, albeit unintentionally. Therefore, this principle has a tremendous impact on CSI. It is one of the most important principles, which directly affects each and every step of investigation, starting from securing the crime scene to analyzing evidence in the laboratory. The third and perhaps the most important principle is Locard's law of exchange. This law was first proposed by an eminent figure in forensic science, also known as the father of modern FS, Dr. Edmund Locard. It states that every contact leaves a trace. Actually, Locard never implied this law in these exact words, and in his vast bibliography, he never mentioned this principle as such. However, he wrote the following sentence: "It is practically impossible for a criminal to commit the crime, especially considering the intensity of a crime, without leaving traces of his presence." Whenever two objects come into contact, there is an exchange of material between them. When you press your finger on a surface will carry the fingerprint, and your finger will carry some constituents of that surface. Similarly, no matter how much the criminal tries, there will always be evidence left behind. The criminal and their instruments will always carry traces from the crime scene and the victim. The victim will carry traces from the crime scene and the criminal. And the crime scene will carry traces from the victim and the criminal. This relationship is known as the forensic linkage triangle. We can move on to further scientific investigation only when this linkage between the criminal, victim, and the crime scene is established. The only catch is to look for them carefully, as most of the incriminating evidence is generally not visible to the naked eye. If the evidence is not detected rapidly, the law of progressive change kicks in, which will lead to failure in establishing the linkage. Therefore, this principle forms the foundation of CSI. The law of individuality and other principles help in identification, but identification will certainly not happen if the linkage is not established. Establishing linkage by searching for evidence depends on the correct answer to the question: what are the places or objects with which the criminal or their tools actually came in contact during the commission of the crime? The point of entry at the scene will carry evidence of the criminal's entry, and the point of exit will carry evidence of their exit, such as footprints and more. Glass shards may be found at the point of entry in the case of a burglary. This glass dust might also be recovered from the suspect's clothes or footwear, or any injury caused by the act. The intensity of the presence of such evidence will be more at the actual scene of the crime. Let us illustrate this principle with a case study by the man himself, Dr. Locard. Dr. Locard solved many cases by applying this principle in practice. This is why he is popularly known as the Sherlock Holmes of France. In one such investigation in 1912, a woman named Marie Latelle was found dead at her home. Her boyfriend, Emile Gourbin, was interrogated, and he claimed that he was playing a game of cards at a friend's house. This claim was supported by all his friends, and therefore he was let go. However, when Locard examined the body, he found definite evidence of strangulation. He then called the boyfriend for an investigation. On scraping his fingernails, skin samples were obtained which belonged to the woman. The presence of a certain pink dust, which belonged to the cosmetics from the woman's dressing room, was also established on the suspect. Thus, mutual exchange was established, and the boyfriend was convicted on the basis of incriminating evidence. The fourth principle is the law of probability. It states that all identifications, be it a definite or an indefinite one, are made, consciously or unconsciously, always on the basis of the law of probability. This means that whenever forensic scientists make observations in the course of CSI, they never declare that the identification is certain. They always speak in terms of probability. An expert in the courtroom will always use a phrase like, "The fingerprints found on the crime scene match with those of the suspect. Hence, the accused was most probably present at the scene." So why can't the expert declare that the identification is certain when the fingerprints are matching? This is because, although fingerprints are unique to each person, this knowledge is inductively derived. Here, it is necessary to explain the difference between inductive and deductive reasoning. To keep it simple, deductive reasoning is when knowledge is derived from already established facts. For example, the statement, "All humans are mortal," is a fact. From this statement, it can be deduced that Professor Dave and his viewers are all mortals. On the other hand, inductive reasoning is the generation of knowledge from observations alone. For example, Professor Dave is mortal, his viewers are mortal, my parents are mortal, are observations. From them, it can be inductively derived that all men are mortal, which is a piece of new knowledge. Though this statement sounds like certain knowledge, it is not derived from a fact, but rather observations. Similarly, forensic science is based on observations. Now, coming back to the example of fingerprints, yes, fingerprints are unique, but this statement is not certain as it is concluded from many observations made of fingerprints for about 100 years. It is virtually impossible to observe all fingerprints of every person present on this earth, but if even a single pair of fingerprints is found to be the same, then this common knowledge will be refuted. This is where probability comes into the picture, as these findings are never certain. However, the defense counsel often misunderstands probability and considers it as a tool to plead not guilty due to the presumed lack of a definite opinion. This is why investigation should never be limited to singular evidence. As much evidence as possible should be recovered and analyzed from the triangle, crime scene, victim, and suspects, because it strengthens the case for identification in terms of probability with each piece of evidence. The fifth principle is the principle of comparison. It states that only the likes can be compared. If hair found on the crime scene are of a particular ethnic origin, it is meaningless to collect standard specimens for comparison from a totally unrelated type of person. If the wads from a shotgun are found on the scene, there's no reason to use a high-velocity firearm for studying the properties of the firearm in question. Therefore, this principle conveys an important necessity in CSI that the control samples and specimens used for comparison should always be similar to that of the questioned evidence recovered from the crime scene. The sixth and final principle is the principle of analysis. It states that the analysis can be no better than the sample analyzed. Proper analysis of a sample is only possible if it is intact and uncontaminated. If a piece of evidence is improperly packaged and therefore gets destroyed or contaminated, then its subsequent analysis will be pointless. Let us consider a case of sexual assault. The suspect and the victim have blood groups A and B, respectively. Two pieces of evidence, a cloth bearing a semen stain and another cloth bearing a blood stain, are found. According to protocol, they must be allowed to dry under room temperature and then packaged separately. If they are not dried and are packaged in a single container such that their stain-bearing surfaces touch each other, then there is a high probability that one or both of the stains will give the blood group AB. This result is highly misleading, as neither of the persons involved belong to this group. Therefore, this principle points towards the most important necessity in CSI, collecting and packaging the evidence correctly so that optimal analysis is possible. And with that, we have covered the principles of forensic science. Their importance is realized in almost every step of the investigation. These steps include protecting the crime scene, recognizing evidence, searching for evidence, their collection, packaging and transportation, analysis in the laboratory, and finally, the presentation of the results in the courtroom. Let's move forward and begin to learn about this procedure in great detail.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.